Good morning, Seaside. It's good to be with you. Excited to sing praises to our God, to our King, our Savior. So join us.
Father everlasting, the old creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. Yeah. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again.
Opportunity to gather and to sing your praises. God, would these praises be a sweet fragrance rising up to you? Would you be glorified and magnified by our praise and our worship? We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you, Raquel. Thank you, band. What an amazing opportunity to just sing of the goodness of God. Well, good morning, Seaside. It's so good to see you on the other side of those cameras. But we are just excited to be able to be together, even though we're in separate locations. And, you know, I'll tell you, this is week 13 of us not being able to gather together as one big church family, and that's wearing on us. And also, this past week has been a very emotional week, and all kinds of challenges and things that are before us. And I kept hearing something from the Lord all week, and the word is just grace. I wonder, like, am I doing enough? And you know, my role here at Seaside, am I doing enough? And God's saying, grace, give yourself some grace. And then the big, big word to me is give grace to others. Right now, this time is a time that demands that we are graceful people. So I want to ask the Lord to fill each one of us, overflow his grace upon us, that we could be dispensers of his grace to those we come in contact with. So I want to encourage you with that. Today, near the end of the service, we're going to have communion together. We're going to partake of the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus together. And so if you're in your home watching this right now and you don't have a piece of bread or cracker or whatever you're going to use, could you maybe gather that? And we're just going to have communion all together virtually. So we're kind of excited about that. A number of you came by today and picked up bread and some juice, and it's always happy to see your faces inside your cars as you do that. And at this time, I'm going to introduce Miss Ashleen, who's going to bring us our little fireside chat this morning for those of you in the camp and those of you from the preschool. So welcome, Miss Ashleen.
Hey, guys. How are you today? I was just roasting some marshmallows over here, but too bad you guys can't be here to join me and eat these yummy s'mores. But I just wanted to say hello, and I'm so excited to be a part of this morning with you guys for Little Fireside Chats. And if you don't know who I am, my name's Miss Ashleen, like Miss Pastor Larry said, and I get to teach all of the camp kids. So that's kindergarten all the way through fifth grade. And if you're a little one today, I'm so excited you get to join us, and you get to see me in a couple years, and I'm so excited for that. So today, I get to introduce our Little Fireside Chats. You got to see Miss Laura and Mr. Scott last week, and today I get to share with you what Little Fireside Chats is. Each Sunday during our adult service, we get an opportunity to engage with you, and I think this is so special because Miss Laura and I have missed you so much, and your camp leaders and your little ones leaders have missed you too, and so each week we get to share something special with you out of God's Word. So this week, we are so excited to share with you our Remember Verse. Does everyone remember what that is? Yeah, it's memorizing scripture. Now, why do we memorize scripture? Each one of you turn to your parent and kind of think about and tell your parent why we memorize scripture. Okay, I'm going to tell you a little secret too. My favorite part about memorizing scripture is that when I'm going through a tough time or a good time or a confusing time, and I just need a little reassurance from God, I think back to all the scripture I was able to memorize, and I think, hey, that's God talking to me. Did you guys know that the Holy Spirit can work through you and he can use the scripture you memorize to give you a little conversation with God? So that's why we memorize scripture. So this morning, I want to share this passage with you. Are you guys ready? Okay, let's get our felt board back here. My camp kids, you guys might remember this. Sometimes we take a word off, and then you guys had to tell me which word it was. But today, let's read it together. Whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And this comes out of 1 Corinthians 10:31. Now, let's read it one more time. Let's slow down, and I want you guys to read it with me. Are you ready? Whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. 1 Corinthians 10:31. Now, I love this scripture because it makes me stop throughout my week. And this is kind of what I want you guys to do this week too. It makes me stop and it makes me think, whatever I do, whether that's eating dinner or drinking my favorite coffee drink in the morning, or maybe it might be if I was in an argument with someone, or maybe playing on a playground with people I don't know. Whatever I do, I want to honor those around me, and I want to glorify our awesome, awesome God. Because when we glorify God, that shows others around us who God is. And, you know, Paul's going to explain to the Corinthian church this morning through what John's going to share, that sometimes, even when we think we're doing the right thing, we're sometimes causing other people to make bad choices around us or to sin. And so if you can stop this week and think, every situation that I'm in, I want to make a choice that's honoring those around me and that's showing others around me how awesome and wonderful our God is, and that will glorify him. Isn't that awesome? Okay, you guys, so that's your challenge. Think about, in all things, how do you glorify God and honor those around you? Okay, we're going to read our remember verse one more time. Are you guys ready? Are you sure? Okay, read it with me. I want you guys to read it loud. Whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. 1 Corinthians 10:31. Okay, awesome. Great job, guys. So, parents, this is your opportunity to go online at seasidehb.org/curriculum. And when you see the little ones in camp curriculum, you'll get to see a PDF printout that you can print out for your kids to memorize their scripture this week. And then you also have attached a music video that can help your kids sing along. Okay, you guys, so fun hanging out with you guys today. Have a great day.
Welcome. Thank you for joining with us this morning. Ashleen, thank you so much for that memory verse. And we're going to be looking at that verse today as a whole church. I have to tell you that I stand here today humble. Never probably felt as inadequate to come and share as this Sunday, in light of our volatile culture and what's going on right now. It's just heartbreaking what's been going on And I've been thinking, like, oh, John, what are you going to say? What's, you know, what can one white pastor do or say? And I've been thinking about, just in my own little world, some of the questions that have been coming to my mind, and just share my heart for a little bit. I was thinking at one point this week, I was reaching out and talking to my beautiful, beautiful friends who are African-American, and just listening and trying to hear and understand the story and what's going on. And at the same time, I have family, and there's people in our church family that are police officers, and you're just like this, oh, man, it was just hard to get my mind. The only thing that I could think about that comes close to this feeling that I was experiencing is when Monica and I had a really good friends that we loved both of the husband and the wife, and when they were going through a divorce, it was like, oh, man, who do we pick here? Where do we go? And it's difficult, difficult times. And what I feel confident about is that it's not about me, it's not about you. It's really, and the message today, what I'm going to encourage us and I'm going to pray for is that we would come to God's word and allow God's word to speak to us. Because I believe that God is speaking into our cultural climate right now. I could not be happier that we're going through the book of 1 Corinthians, and I believe that even where we are in 1 Corinthians is speaking to our issues today. And what I want to encourage all of us, no matter where you are listening to this, if we can just bring our feelings and our opinions and our thinking and allow them to be filtered through God's word and through these beautiful scriptures that God has given to us. God breathes his word, and he still wants this word to be breathed into our life and our souls. And so I'd like to spend a moment and just pray for us as our time today. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and through the first verse of chapter 11. So would you take a moment, bow your heads, and pray with me? Father, I thank you. You are God and God alone. No one but you. Thank you, Father, for your steadfast love. Thank you, Father, that nothing that's taking place in our world today, whether the coronavirus, whether all the protests, whatever, Lord, this has not taken you by surprise. And we believe you are working. You are refining. And we pray, Lord, that all of us could just come today with humble hearts to hear what you have said to us in your scriptures. And we thank you for this time. We thank you for this freedom to study together and to look at your word. And I thank you in the name of Jesus. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, there was a question that the Corinthian church was dealing with, and it started in chapter 8. And it was about food that was sacrificed to idols in the church. And Jimmy and Scott, the last couple weeks, have been taking us through these chapters. There's actually three chapters dealing with this food that's been sacrificed to idols. And I'm sure you're sitting here today, you're at the edge of your seat thinking like, oh yeah, so thankful, John, you're dealing with this issue, because I've been struggling with this issue all week long, food sacrificed to idols. If I could see you all in person, I would ask, has anyone Could you please raise your hand if that's been your struggle this week? And there wouldn't be one single hand go up. No one's been struggling with food sacrificed to idols. This was a big deal in the Corinthian church. The principles in these chapters and the answers that Paul gives to them and where Paul points them through this issue of meat sacrificed to idols are the same principles, the same truth that we can apply in our world right today, right now, because these principles stand true. I'm actually excited because they're so relevant right now in our world. And I want to begin, I've titled today, Beautiful Life-Giving Questions. All of us, you know, we wake up every day, questions that go through our mind, you know, wake up in the morning, what am I going to eat, you know, what am I going to wear, what do I have to do today? We have our lists, and these questions just come through our minds. How did that person ever get a driver's license, you know, like, how long is this corona thing going to happen, and why me? You know, it's that our minds just are constantly at so many different levels asking questions. And I was thinking, what would it be like today if we would bring our minds and our thoughts and our thinking into the scripture and start asking some different questions? So I have a few questions for us today. And I've entitled this, they're beautiful life-giving questions if we would put our mind in this space. So they're found in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, starting at verse 14. And I'm going to ask you to be sensitive to your questions. Question number one, what would it be like? What, just think for a minute, if we were asking this question, will I keep Jesus as my highest love? Will I keep Jesus as my highest love? Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, starting in verse 14. And again, Scott covered last week these first 13 verses where Paul goes back and he dives into Israel's history and talks about where they blew it with their idolatry and different sins. And he's bringing us to this place. And in verse 14, it says, therefore, whenever there's a therefore, okay, Paul is tying this whole section from chapter 8, from food sacrifice to idol, all the way through chapter 10, three chapters dealing with this. But he's concluding now, and he says, therefore, my dear friends, Paul has this pastoral love for them. My dear friends, flee from idolatry. I speak to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. Paul is calling upon them to think about their life and about their love, about who they're following, who they're worshiping. And Paul starts this section and he says, run from idolatry. In chapter 6, verse 18, Paul encourages us when in that section about sexual immorality, Paul says, flee, run from sexual immorality. Idolatry is so similar to adultery. It's so similar to sexual immorality because our soul, just like there's no such thing as casual sex, as we looked at that back in chapter 6, Paul's now going to say, your heart and what your heart attaches to is of infinite importance. And so Paul says, flee from idolatry. And again, Jimmy, Scott, we've been talking about this Corinthian church, how, man, you couldn't even go to the butchery and buy a, you know, filet mignon that probably wasn't sacrificed to some idol, you know, in that culture. It was very, very prevalent. And then in verse 16 it says, is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. for we all share the one loaf. And so to make this connection, Paul is saying, flee idolatry, and then he moves into the Lord's table, to communion. And this early church would practice communion together, and Paul draws his attention to this beautiful act, and he uses four times this idea of participation or koinonia. It's a very beautiful word of partnership, of fellowship to one another. And Paul is going to bring us to this place of idolatry is your partnering, your fellowship, your giving your love. And he brings us to the Lord's table and he says, man, we are participants of Jesus Christ and his body. We are one body coming together for this beautiful act of remembering Jesus' death and his resurrection. I like in verse 16 where it says this cup of thanksgiving. What is this cup of thanksgiving? And during their meal, they would probably, for the most common way of this meal, they would have four cups of wine, and the third cup of wine was the cup of thanksgiving. And as they would remember their deliverance from Egypt and the blood of the lamb that was shared, and Paul's just so, it's fascinating how he's just drawing this to the current time where he's saying, you guys are participation together of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ and what he did. Verse 18, it says, consider the people of Israel. Do not those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar? Do I mean then that food sacrificed to an idol is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons and not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. Are we trying to arouse the Lord's jealousy? Are we stronger than he? I was thinking about this picture, and hopefully this will make a little bit of sense to us, because this was the best I could do with bringing out my home idols that I got from Haiti when I was there, and I'm losing my props, and from Africa. And Paul would be saying, no matter what your idol is, and there were many, and Paul would just say, man, there's no participation between the Lord's Supper and these idols. And Paul would go on and say, man, these idols that are, you know, carved out of wood or stone, whatever, they're nothing. It's just wood. But what's behind this idol, our love affection. I have to get my prop, sorry. Because I was thinking about, you know, we would look at this and go, oh, this is kind of ridiculous. And like, who would love an idol like this? But what is some of our idols? Scott talked about it last week. Some of our idols would be self-idolatry. I was putting this money up, and I was thinking, man, for some people, this is our idol. We look at this as our love. This is what brings pleasure. This is what brings security to me. This is my worship. And what's behind this, Paul would say, is absolutely demonic. All right, there is a fight for our souls and for your love and for your affection. And just like a husband who would say, man, I am not sharing my wife with any other man, God, all the way through scriptures, is saying, I want to be first place, the highest place, the utmost place in your life. And when you come to the communion table, I don't want to share you and your love with anyone else. In Exodus chapter 20, 1 through 5, last year when we were going through Exodus and we looked at God giving the law, and in verse 1, then God gave the people all these instructions. And look at instruction number 1. I am the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt, the place of your slavery. You must not have any other God but me. I love you, God sang. I rescued you. I am the one that can give you life and meet your need. Why would you go and serve and love and bow down to any other God, whether it's made out of stone or paper? Why would you do this? Jesus said you cannot serve God and money. God's not going to share our affection with anything else. He goes on in verse 4 of Exodus and he says, you must not make for yourself an idol of any kind or an image of anything in the heavens or on the earth or in the sea. You must not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God who will not tolerate your affection for any other gods. God is jealous like a husband with his wife. I'm not going to share my affection. God wants our highest love. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, and this Shema, which the Israelites would memorize and quote and say daily, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." This is what God wants. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Jesus reiterated that when he was asked a question in Matthew 22, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replied, "To love the Lord your God with all your heart." This is what God has always wanted. He doesn't want to share your affection. He wants to be and deserves. And when we stop and pause and think about who our God is, he deserves this highest place in my heart. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And this is the first and greatest commandment. This is God's greatest desire from each and every one of us. What worship does is it connects us to the one we worship. If we are worshiping God, our hearts, our souls, and that's what Paul is saying in Corinthians, we are participants, we are connected, we are worshiping our God, and our souls and our love is connected to him, our worship. There's an interesting example in the scriptures to me, and it's the church of Ephesus when Paul wrote this letter to the Ephesians. There's a section here that I really love in chapter 3 because Paul's praying for them. And here's his prayer. He says, "Then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide and how long and how high and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God." You read this Bible, and what we see is this divine romance where God has poured himself out over and over again, showing his love for his people to all who would want to trust him and love him. And as a response back from those that he loves, the beloved that he loves, he wants this love coming back to him. After Paul wrote that letter to the Ephesians, 35 years went by, and the apostle John wrote a letter to this same church at Ephesus. In Revelation chapter 2, it says, "Write this letter to the angel of the church in Ephesus. This is the message from the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know all the things that you do. I have seen your hard work and your patience, patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You have discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting." This church was doing a lot of things really, really well. But then verse 4 comes in. "But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. If you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place among the churches." The same verse out of the message says, I see what you've done, your hard, hard work, your refusal to quit. I know you can't stomach evil, that you weed out apostolic pretenders. I know your persistence, your courage in my cause, that you never wear out. This church was a working church. They were doing so many things well. But you walked away from your first love. Why? What's going on with you anyway? Do you have any idea how far you've fallen? A Lucifer fall. Turn back. Recover your dear early love. No time to waste, for I'm well on my way to removing your light from the golden circle. And so this big question, how will I keep God number one? No matter what culture, no matter what idols have ever come, God is wanting this place in our heart, this place of love and adoration and trusting him and clinging to him. Question number two, will I live my life, if I can be thinking about this, will I live life to benefit others? Scott talked about this last week. This one of the biggest idols that we have is self-idolatry, this sense of entitlement and the worship of me and my opinions and me first. And the Bible comes against this and really wants to set us free from this limited idolatry of self. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, let's keep going. If Jesus is my first love, then there's a follow-up that if I'm loving him, it's going to flow out to other people. And Paul says it like this in verse 23 of 1 Corinthians 10. I have the right to do anything, you say. And that's what the church was saying. We have freedom now. We can do anything we want. But not everything is beneficial. And Paul keeps reiterating this. He said this over and over again. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. No one should seek their own good, but the good of others. Eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience. For the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And quote Psalm 24. Basically, Paul would say, man, if you have a good filet mignon in front of you, eat it without, just enjoy that thing. It's not, again, these idols are nothing. God made it all. If an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever's put before you without raising questions of conscience. Now, for someone like me, I just say a big amen to that. Man, what's put in front of me? Boy, yeah, let's thank the Lord and indulge. But if someone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then do not eat it, both for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of conscience. I'm referring to the other person's conscience and not yours. Paul is just simply saying, hey, if you're at a meal, someone comes in, a brother, and this is the theme throughout these three chapters, someone comes in, they're like, hey, that meat's been sacrificed to idol. Set it aside. Eat your salad. Enjoy that. I'm referring to the other person's conscience, not yours. For why is my freedom being judged by another's conscience? If I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? Paul, I believe, is not talking about us as believers just being this milquetoast, you know, doormat. It's not that. What Paul is emphasizing here is that we learn to grow in our sensitivity and that we're putting other people ahead of ourselves and what I, you know, my rights, I can do this. And what about the other person? What if this might stumble them? What if this might hurt their faith? And Paul is bringing this church to a place of just mutual sensitivity to one another. And it's hard. It's not easy. It is, this kind of love is hard love. It's not the simple love. It's difficult at times. When Jesus said to love your enemies, that's not an easy thing. That's a difficult thing. But in the church, Paul says, man, take care of one another. Be sensitive to each other and their conscience and what's going on in their world. In Romans 12:10, Paul says, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. And that's a key value in the New Testament and throughout Scripture. Put other people above yourself. How will I do that? We've been looking at Philippians chapter 2 over and over and over and over again and over again. I was telling Jimmy this week, I was like, hey, we're going to have to talk about Philippians again. And we're like, yep, here it is. Because Paul put it so well. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. What would our culture look like today if we would take this verse to heart and we would simply say, man, I'm not going to be selfish in this. I'm going to filter my opinions. I'm going to filter my feeling. I'm going to filter everything through the very word of God. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. And Paul goes on, talks about the humility and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And so Paul's answer to this situation in Corinth with meat sacrificed to idols, or whether it's our current situation, it still points us back to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Look at Jesus. Look at who he is. Look at how he lived. That's our model. That's what we need to go for. Jimmy, a couple weeks ago, used a word, and I want to put this word back up right in front of us. Scott talked about it last week, and it's the word empathy. Love will show itself in empathy, where empathy is just getting inside the skin, getting inside, walking in the shoes of someone else, getting inside of them and understanding. One way that we show empathy is, Scott ended with this verse last week in James 1:19. It says, understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. In the message, it says, post this at all the intersections, dear friends. Lead with your ears. Lead with your ears. Follow up with your tongue. And let anger straggle along in the rear. God's righteousness doesn't grow from human anger. I know this much right now, and this week I've asked friends, African-American dear friends, and they're all saying the same thing. Please listen to us. Please listen to us. Please listen to us. Feel us. Think about what we have gone through for all this, all the injustices. And love would say, yes, I need to have empathy. I need to listen. I need to learn. I need to grow and understand. This is what my dear brothers and sisters have been walking through for a long time. That's being devoted in love to one another. The third question is this. How will I put the spotlight on Jesus? How can I live this life of mine in this time, in this world that we're living in? How do I put the spotlight on Jesus? Paul would say this, starting in verse 31. So whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it for the glory of God. That's our memory verse today, and I hope we memorize it. Whatever you do, whether you eat or drink, do it for the glory of God. That word glory is a really tricky word, but the best way for me to describe it is the spotlight. I'm going to glorify, I'm going to put the spotlight on Christ. Not Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether Jews, Greeks, or the church of God. Even if I try to please everyone in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. Paul would say in his life, man, I am doing my best to put the spotlight on Jesus. If I have to sacrifice, if I have to like give in some of my way, some of my opinions, it is well worth it. Because that's how I'm going to love God, is I'm going to put the spotlight on his son, Jesus Christ. I love the words of John the Baptist. When John was talking and people were saying, hey, are you the Messiah? And John says in John chapter 3, John the Baptist replies, it is not the bridegroom who marries the bride. Is it not the bridegroom who marries the bride? And the bridegroom's friend is simply glad to stand with him and hear his vows. Therefore, I am filled with joy at his success. He must become greater and greater, and I must become less and less. As the crowds were kind of moving away from John the Baptist out there at the Jordan River and starting to like look to this Jesus, and some of John's followers were like, hey, are we concerned about this? And John's like, oh no, that's why I am here. That is my role, is to put the spotlight on the Lamb of God, the Son of God. He must become greater and I must become less. He has come from above and is greater than anyone else. We are of the earth and we speak of earthly things, but he has come from heaven and is greater than anyone else. The way we put Jesus first is to put others first. John 13:35, by this everyone will know you're my disciples. Everyone will know that you're a follower of mine if you love one another. 1 John 4, it says, dear friends, since God so loved us, since he's utmost in our heart, he's our first love, he is our ultimate object of worship and love because we're responding to his love. He says, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. I've been thinking a lot this week about Martin Luther King. I love that man. He had a lot of pressure on him from different African-American organizations, Malcolm X and others that were trying to like influence him. Hey, these peaceful marches of yours aren't helping anything. They're not doing anything. We need to respond with violence. This is way back in the 60s, 1965, 66, 67, 68. And Martin Luther King was tenacious and he was strong. And he knew the scriptures, his life was just saturated with God's word. And he realized that hate and violence will never change a heart. Only love will change a heart. If there's a whatever ethnic group you are in, if you hate another ethnic group, hatred and violence will only throw fuel on that fire. It will never change a heart. God knows what will change a heart. And it comes to his son, Jesus Christ. And it's his love of sacrificial, his death on a cross. And that brings us to this place. Actually, one more question here. In what ways am I becoming more like Jesus? The end of 1 Corinthians 10, Paul says, even if I try to please everyone in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. And then Paul concludes this section in the first verse of chapter 11. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Ephesians chapter 5, Paul says, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us, gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. I became a Christian at age 19, And when I was somewhere around 22 or 23 years old, I remember in my really, really cool 1966 Ford Econoline van, it just had big fat tires, and I thought, man, this is the coolest thing on the planet. And I remember switching from 8-track to cassette tape, and man, I went and, you know, bought all the newest of Christian artists, you know, Randy Stonehill, Larry Norm, all these guys. And it was during that time, though, that I got this cassette tape of Chuck Smith, some of Chuck Smith's quotes put to music. And you young people will love the music that was on that. It was like, you know, seek ye first the kingdom of God, or, you know, one of those classics. But there was one segment on that cassette tape that just I rewound and rewound and listened to it over and over and over again. And Chuck's message was simply this: if all Christians lived just like you lived, what kind of church would it be? If everyone loved like you love, what would the church look like? If everyone sacrificed and served just like you, what would the church look like today? If everyone gave and supported just like you, what kind of church would it be? What would it look like? As a young 20-year-old, I am not kidding, through tears, I would listen and rewind that and pray, Lord Jesus, help me. Help me to be an imitator of Jesus Christ. His life, the way he lived, the way he did life, is true life. If I can get my mind thinking about the questions that I presented with you today, how do I become more like him? How do I love God first? How do I think about other people before myself? What kind of world would it be? Folks, I can't change the world. I can change this one white man right here and ask these questions. What could I do? How can I love? How can I be more like Jesus Christ? Today, if you have the elements of communion, Paul spoke about communion in this chapter, and he talks about this beautiful participation that we have in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul's calling us to take this loaf, and as in that early church, they were breaking that bread, and it was just a simple reminder of the body of Christ broken. It was a reminder of his body that's just willingly laid out for redemption, for the payment, for the sins, all the failure, all the sins, you name the sins. And Jesus' body was broken for those sins. And he took this cup, and after giving thanks, the cup of thanksgiving, he says, this is the new covenant in my blood. Take this and drink this. Please remember my blood, blood on my forehead with that crown of thorns, the nails that pierced my hands and my feet, the spear that went up into my side and poured out on just a barren, forsaken hill called Golgotha, the hill of the skull. And it's there that our God poured out his love, poured himself out with inexpressible love. I don't have all the solutions that our world needs right now, but I believe Scripture does. I believe Jesus does. And I believe that when we come and we participate with him and we join him and we have him first and foremost in our hearts, our band's going to come up right now, and I'm going to encourage you listening that you would just distribute the elements of communion, that you would take this bread. bread broken for you, Christ's body broken for you, and together we participate, this koinonia, with the very presence of the Holy Spirit. So in your homes, take this bread broken for you. Take this cup in remembrance of what Jesus Christ has done for you and for me and for our world. In the name of Jesus.
forget strangers' names. Our blood is one. Children, generations of every nation, His kingdom. Don't let your heart be troubled. Hold your head up high, don't feel evil. Fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Yeah.
On this one fact, this one truth, that God is madly in love with you. Church, whoever's listening today, I'm asking, pleading with all of us, imitate Jesus. Imitate him. There's never been a greater time for the church to shine than now. How will we display and show and live and walk in this love? So wherever you are, I ask that you would just filter all your feelings and your opinions, filter it through the gospel, filter it through the fact that God is madly in love with us. And he wants us to be madly in love with him and display that to our world. God bless you. Have a good day. We've been getting some pictures of people meeting together. It's helpful. Let us know who's been watching with you, and hope you enjoy your fellowship together. God bless you, Seaside.